A very warm welcome to all of you in line already. We are very happy that you have joined our web seminars, so our series of web seminars, which take place instead of the not taking place Interpack this year, which was a very sad information for us. And so we decided that we will do a virtual event series for you that we can share with you great examples from BASF, which we actually wanted to show you at the Interpack this year. So, as you know, we will have this event series started on Monday and it will last until next week, Thursday. So please still feel free to register for the rest of our webinars. And today we have an amazing topic for you. So we will share with you some insights about the sustainable product offerings for our extrusion polymers. And for that, I would like to introduce to you our expert who is with me today in line. And this is Frank Reil. Frank Reil is our head of marketing and new business development head for the polyamides. And so, Frank, I'm very happy to have you in this call and that you share your insights with us. My name is Nina Austin. I'm in the communications department of the monomers division in BASF and responsible for the communications of polyamides. So whenever you have a technical hiccup today or any issue, please let me know. I try to help you. You can chat me directly via WebEx and then I try to solve your issue. So before we go into details, I would like to share some WebEx housekeeping rules with you. So please provide your full name when you dial in. Do not appear as a dial-in user, and we have put you all per default on mute. So whenever you would like to address a question to Frank, please use the chat functionality or also the Q&A function on the right-hand side of WebEx, or you can also raise your hand virtually so we can unmute you and you can ask your question directly. We will answer all your questions after the session, and we would like to ask you, please turn off your video. Frank for sure will have it on that you can see him. And I will turn it off in a minute to also spare or save some bandwidth. We recommend you to use voice over IP connection, so the call using computer function. And also for your information, we are recording this session today. We will exclude the Q&A at the end. So, but for the colleagues and people, interested audience who is not able to join today, we will prepare that on our website and we will send to all of you a link beginning of next week so that you have the content ready and also the recording. One last remark, we are a couple of colleagues teams here in line, so some people online already, you can only see yourself. And the reason is that from a data protection point of view, we do not want to show each and everyone who's in this call, but I can tell you we have a broad audience already with us. So you have to keep in mind, we are not alone here. And with that, I hand over to Frank. So Frank, I will hand you over the ball and then you can share your screen and start the content.
So I trust you can all see my slide and hear me well.
Yes, when you go exactly to presentation mode, then it's perfect.
Okay, so good afternoon and good morning to colleagues in North and South America. So I would like to introduce today some sustainable Ultramid extrusion polymers. And sustainable has many meanings, yeah. But I think the recycling topic, as well as product carbon footprint, is a hot topic currently in the industry. So I prepared an agenda for you. So first, I would like to let you know what we understand from product carbon footprint, talk shortly about the polyamide 6 value chain, about our sustainable product offerings. Then shortly, I would like to explain something about the Verbund and the mass balance, because the biomass balance and chem cycling sustainable offerings, they are mass balance products. And then some slides to our offerings today and tomorrow. And what does it mean in terms of impacting our customer end products? So when we talk about product carbon footprint, then we talk about like the ISO standard 14067 from cradle to gate. So it's basically until the products are leaving our gate at BASF. So it contains of scope 3. So this is basically the upstream. Actually, it's a raw material we are buying as BASF. And then we can use PCF data from our suppliers if they are available, or we use database values to calculate scope 3. Then we have scope 2. This is basically if we buy energy. Those emissions are covered with that one. And scope 1 are the real emissions basically BASF is creating. And in terms like the Verbund plants we have, we are generating our own energy. Then basically this moves from scope 2 to scope 1. And further down, this is not covered by the sheer PCF number, but there is an exception in case of chem cycling, for example. What you can do if waste gets incinerated, for example, then you also can include it into your scope and basically get credits for not burning it, not putting it into incineration and using this kind of waste product for producing new products out of it. This is a very simplified chart now about the production of polyamide 6. So on the left side, you see benzene, sulfur and natural gas. These are our raw materials we are buying, we are taking into our plant. And then the cyclohexane, anolone goes into caprolactam. On the sulfur side, the sulfuric acid we have plants, ammonia, hydroxylamine, and this all basically is needed to produce caprolactam. And out of the monomer caprolactam, you produce a polymer, polyamide 6. For this production, we certainly need steam, but we have also some plants who are generating steam, so they're generating more steam than they need. And for those steam, you get some credits because in the Verbund, we are using this steam and not it's not a kind of emission. And all the byproducts we are producing, in case of caprolactam, ammonium sulfate, for example, this one is a byproduct we are selling. And here we also get over certain allocation rules. If we calculate the product carbon footprints, get every product, so to say, a fair share of the total PCF. And then we are able to calculate the product carbon footprint. And as we are backward integrated pretty much, then we can use our own data and we do not rely so much on data from databases. So our offerings, the fundamental offerings we can give you today, has basically two sides. So one, we talk about biomass balance. On the other side, we talk about chem cycling. So it's always waste-based, which means we are using waste, tall oil, for example, which can be generated to bionafta. This is a waste product in the paper production. The kitchen waste is kitchen waste, which you throw away. You can generate biomethane out of it. And in terms of chem cycling, it's both a pyrolysis of mixed plastic waste or end-of-life tires. And all those input we can bring into the Verbund, either on the syngas plant or in the cracker. And then we can generate a lot of products in BASF Verbund site, like Ultramid A, Ultramid B, C, or adipic acid, in case you are interested in. So this is a picture of our Verbund site in Ludwigshafen. This should illustrate that it's not so easy to have a Verbund production, and it's also pretty complicated. So we do not have small dedicated production lines for chem cycling or biomethane product. So we are using the existing assets, meaning it's a mass balance approach we are applying here. So basically at the north part of Ludwigshafen site, we are bringing in the gas and the oil. We have here the syngas plant, we have two crackers, and then all the way down, all the byproducts and products gets distributed via pipes. So we have a pipeline system of 2,800 kilometers within our plant. And we are also generating our own energy here. And here we have combined heat and power generator. Who are very effective in terms of product carbon footprint. So I talked about mass balance. The mass balance is in principle easy to understand. I think that every one of you know green electricity, biofuel, or the Better Cotton Initiative. So all these are mass balance approaches, which are since many, many years established in the industry. For the chemical industry, basically we do the same. So we have an oil tank, and here we can bring it bio-naphtha, for example, or pyrolysis oil. And then we are utilizing our very efficient Verbund plants. All the steps in between and the allocation to the final products are all certified by external parties, and they get reviewed every year. I mean, in the course of the production, you always have losses. And in order to allocate always 100% to the final product, you need to add in the very beginning more products than you have at the end. So we are producing 100% mass balanced products at the end of the production chain. So now we focus shortly on the biomass balance. So we are very careful what we take in. So we do not want to have the discussion, for example, if you would feed corn in or corn-based biomethane, that you can also feed it somehow. So therefore, we are very picky what we are taking in. So it's biogas, as mentioned, from kitchen waste, for example, or bio-naphtha from vegetable or organic waste oils. So this is very important for us. So we also apply international sustainability criteria to the feedstock, like checking the reduction of greenhouse gas emissions, looking for environmental and social responsibility biomass production, and we are looking at protecting areas with high biodiversity and or high carbon stocks. And all our bio waste streams, they're all certified. So they are certified according to ISCC, RSPO, RedCept, and we are also in contact in dialogue here with NGOs that we don't have a discussion afterwards what we are taking in. So was the bio mass balance part. And now I would like to elaborate a bit on the chemcycling. I mean, you all know the mechanical recycling stream. If you have pure product, then you can make a mechanical recycling. But the problem here is if you look for mixed plastic waste, for example, even so you sort it out, that you have polyethylene and polypropylene sorted, PET, for example. So it's with the exception of PET, basically not possible to make a mechanical recycling with end-of-life product and bringing it back into the food value chain, because you will not have food contact for it. Then we have the depolymerization. This is from polymers which contains of a single monomer, for example, at PS6. This, in principle, you can bring back to from polyamide 6 to caprolactam and then make new polyamide 6 out of it again. But today I would like to focus on the chemcycling. It's a pyrolysis, so we go back to the very beginning of the value chain with this kind of approach. And just to make it clear that we see the chemcycling complementary to mechanical recycling. So all what can be mechanical recycled in a good way should be mechanical recycled, but a lot of goods cannot be recycled mechanically, and therefore the chemical recycling is a good way doing so. Okay, what we are doing as we speak, basically, so we have two sources. We have mixed plastic waste and we have end-of-life tires. And so those feedstock go into a pyrolysis plant. Here we are working with three external partners. We are getting this pyrolysis oil into BASF in the Verbund plant. Here we have two entry points, actually. So it's a syngas plant or the cracker. This bar here indicates that those two plants are connected to each other, and there's also some material going back and forth. And out of it, you produce your reformate, your benzene, cyclohexanone, anolone, caprolactam, and finally a PA6. So, and if you look a bit more closer to the pyrolysis process, you may ask yourself how much oil we can get out of a mixed plastic waste. And typically, we are around 70%. So if you feed in 100 tons, you get 70 tons of pyrolysis oil out of it. So the rest, you have some char at the end, but mainly you produce also gas. And here, you can influence it by the temperature you run. So the higher the temperature, the more gas you are generating. But as we would like to have pyrolysis oil, we run the process, or our partner runs the process, that it is self-sufficient, meaning that the gas which is generated is feeding or bringing in the energy to the process, and the pyrolysis oil gets purified, and this is a must. Yeah, so there is no pyrolysis oil, even not with 100% polyethylene used, that you can feed into the cracker, because a cracker is a very sensitive animal. So you need really to make sure that you meet the specification, and therefore the purification step is absolutely necessary. And then you can produce 100% identical plastic with food contact and everything out of it. Maybe some of you asking yourself if you can bring it, if you can everything in the pyrolysis plant. So we can prove that a PEPA film can be mechanically recycled. So we did a lot of trials already. So you see here a film, a low barrier film, 97% polyolefins and 3% EVOH. Then you have a yield of 72%. And then we did the same trials with only 66% of polyolefins, 25% polyamide, and 9% EVOH. And here we just get a 2% lower yield. So it's, I think, really not a lot. Certainly, if you put such products in to the pyrolysis, it contains heteroatoms like nitrogen and oxygen. Therefore, hydrotreatment is necessary, but this will be the case for all pyrolysis oils. And also the gas phase, it depends what you put in. You get some side products, but the post-treatment of gases is very typical in the chemical industry. This also is not a big issue at all. So how will this results translate into real-life scenarios? You know that the polyamide fraction in mixed plastic waste is around 1.7%. If we now think, okay, more and more polyethylene and polypropylene get sorted out, then you are still under 5%, and this should be far lower than the 25% we have proven that it works. So hydrotreatment is recommended for any oil. And we in BASF, we have also syngas plants, which brings in a higher tolerance for nitrogen. So this is our input point as of now. And what you may have read is that we have a BASF commitment. So we as BASF will consume 250,000 tons of plastic waste in 2025, with special attention to polyamide. So we go and will use 250,000 tons of waste and turn it into new virgin-like products again. And if you are going to buy chem cycling products, here you see the technical data sheet. You can realize that the technical data are exactly the same like a standard product. And this is because we are using standard recipes. We are starting at the very beginning of the value chain, using the same assets, so exactly the same. And for that reason, we are able to also conduct food contact certificates, and all the process is externally certified, so you can get such kind of certification from external parties as well. So, and this makes it possible, what you see here, I mean, as you should be pretty much aware of it, you can already buy it in the supermarket. So these two examples show that it works, you have food contact and you can reuse the polyamide chemical recycling one again and again. If we talk about the claims, and this is what you can always say, is that you have basically replaced fossil feedstock with waste-based feedstock, and you can also claim that you save CO2, so the product carbon footprint of those products are lower. And this leads me to my next slide, basically. And now it is about product carbon footprints. If you calculate your product carbon footprint, if you produce a film, for example, then you need some input data. And if you don't have supplier-specific input data, you typically use databases. Yeah? You see basically here EcoInvent on the very left side, the blue bar. EcoInvent's number for PA6, product carbon footprint, is 8.3. The HIC index is the sustainability index of the textile industry. And here they count the polyamide 6 with 7.38 and Plastic Europe here is a number of 6.7. Plastic Europe's number is from 2014. And this year the process has restarted again. So Plastic Europe with a consultant Sphera is now going to renew this number. And what I do expect is that the number will be a bit lower here overall. Yeah, because all the producers of polyamide try to reduce their product carbon footprint. But what you also can see is that even if you use a standard Ultramid, this is now a fiber grade, but it doesn't matter, as extrusion grades show the same results, you can see that we are significantly better. And this is what I have explained before, so that we have quite efficient processes. But if you go along the road and you would like to even further reduce it, then the post C1 stands for mixed plastic waste based. Post C2 is the old tire product derived of old tires. And then you have the two biomass balance, so derived from biomethane and bio-naphtha. You may wonder why the C2 is higher in value than the C1. And the reason for that is if you run a pyrolysis plant with old tires, then you also generate metal, steel, and carbon black. And these are valuable goods. So we can't get a credit for not burning it because these are, let's say, sold and used again. And so the credits are lower in terms of the mixed of the tires than with the mixed plastic waste. The bio-naphtha at the very right side, we have some business here, but it's very limited, and it's very limited because it's pretty much expensive, more expensive than the others, and the availability is also not there. Yeah? So this has started all, and the bio-naphtha, we are a bit on the lower side. What can we offer you in the future? So what we could do, we could apply green electricity. It's also a biomass balance, so it fits perfectly together. So, and with the use of green electricity from wind, from solar, or from water power, basically we can further significantly reduce the product carbon footprint of those numbers you have seen. So go challenge your supplier of polyamide. Yeah. So if you calculate your product carbon footprint of the film, and you're using databases, these are might be higher than the one you get from your supplier. And I'm pretty confident that we are here best in class. So if you use Ultramid instead of some database values, and we can give you those numbers and the LCAs when you sign an NDA, then I think you're already on a good way. So, and again, to summarize why BASF, Ultramid B and C is on the lower side of the range is because we are backward integrated. So we can use our own site-specific energies and power to calculate with own data our entire value chain. This gives us an advantage. And the Verbund structure, certainly, it's a highly efficient way without packing and transport products from one to the other plant. And I mentioned this cogeneration plant of heat and power, which we have. You can Google it. It always comes with lower product carbon footprint values. And our caprolactam process in BASF comes with no CO2 emissions. Yeah, I think that's an important point, because if you have laughing gas N2O, this has a leverage multiplication factor of close to 300, 298 times CO2. So whenever you have N2O emissions, you would better have an abatement unit for it. Otherwise, your product carbon footprint will be out of range. If you now go one step further and we are looking into what is packed, then you can argue, yeah, but at the very end, if we have a steak or we have a sausage packed, packaging has only a very small part on the total carbon footprint of the packed good. This is right, it depends what is packed, but nevertheless, most of the film producers, specifically the big one, they have already targets in place by how much they would like to reduce their greenhouse gas emissions, like Constantia, 24% by 2030, but also the producer of the food, like Arla, just one example, they also look for packaging reduction, and they would like to reduce their product carbon footprint by 30% in 2030. If you now wonder what is your carbon footprint for the film, and you get a lot of inquiries from our customer about the product carbon footprint, because this is a kind of prerequisite for selling their goods, their film to the end consumer. And here you can see that, I checked a lot of LCAs, and the scope 3 emission is here around 80%. It means this is a product you are using, producing your film. So 80% of your product carbon footprint relies on the product you are buying. It means when you buy a product with a much lower product carbon footprint, then you already reduce your product carbon footprint of the film significantly. The rest is scope two and scope one, which is a minor part. And here you see that one of the film producer, LCA, studies, they use this eco-invent data of 8.3. And if you could imagine that we are in the order of magnitude between 4 and 5, yeah, so you can significantly reduce the product carbon footprint if you use our standard Ultramid. And if you go the next step, you can further reduce it significantly in ordering our chem cycling or biomass dependence product. So that's my last slide, a short summary. I explained why our Ultramid grades are on the lower side of the product carbon footprint you can find. It's because of our Verbund and backward integration. So we offer here also with a biomass balance and the C-cycle products from pyrolysis oil, very sustainable products. I think we have proven and shown that a circular economy for polyamide multilayer films is possible with the pyrolysis, and you can use it back in your film production, also for packing food. And if you remember that the biggest waste stream of plastics is food packaging, basically, and you cannot use it with mechanically recycled again in food packaging. I don't know where you want to put all these films and this waste. Therefore, I think the chem cycling is really a good way. So our sustainable extrusion polymers can help our customer to achieve their sustainability targets. And the last point, you know that EPR fees are already in place for the yellow bag. So the people who are bringing films in the supermarkets, they need to pay for the collection and the recycling of those films. And you know that the EU has decided now putting 800 euro per ton of film for those films who cannot be recycled on top of the around 400 euro. And in some countries, it's already implemented, like in Italy, that for the 450 euro per ton you need to pay. If you use a recycled product or a bio-based product, you can deduct this amount from the EPR fees you pay. And so, yeah, the European Union is putting a lot of pressure on into this one. And here we think we also get a kind of less fee to pay if you use such sustainable products.
BASF. We create chemistry.